Hi friends, welcome back on our YouTube channel. This is the next lecture of optics, in which today we will discuss about spherical aberration and its reduction. Now before moving to spherical aberration, what is aberration? The spherical surfaces and lenses are used to create the images of given objects. If we find the position, size and forms of images by using simple equations, then there will be several defects or aberration in images. The defects in images formed by a lens or combination of lenses are known as aberration. Now, types of aberration. There are two types of aberration: chromatic aberration and monochromatic aberration. Now, what is chromatic aberration and how will you reduce it? This whole thing we have discussed in our last session. Now, here we will discuss about monochromatic aberration. So monochromatic aberration and spherical aberration, also the reduction of spherical aberration, these three topics we will discuss here. Now monochromatic aberration. So what is monochromatic aberration? If we use monochromatic light in place of white light, then we get some another type of defects in images of objects formed by a lens or combination of lenses. Such defects are known as monochromatic aberration. So if we use monochromatic light in place of white light, then some defects also arises in images of objects. Such defects are known as monochromatic aberration. Since all the marginal rays and paraxial rays does not focus at a single point, and hence this effect arises. Now, first and third order theory. From Abbe's sign condition, mu 1 h 1 sin theta 1 is equal to mu 2 h 2 sin theta 2. Here mu 1 h 1 and theta 1 are refractive index, transverse size of an object, and angle subtended by object ray with principal axis respectively. In the same way, mu 2 h 2 and theta 2 are refractive index, transverse size of an image, and angle subtended by image ray with principal axis respectively. Since the law of refraction is mainly based on sine theta, so the value of sine theta is responsible for the lens aberration. From Maclaurin's series, sin theta equal to theta minus theta cube upon factorial 3 plus theta raised to 5 upon factorial 5 minus, and so on. For paraxial rays and distant object and image, the value of theta is very small, and hence sin theta is nearly equal to theta, because when theta is small, then sin theta will be nearly equal to theta. So for small values of theta, the sin series will be converged to first order term, and this theory is known as first order theory of image formation, because here we are using only first order. So this theory is known as first order theory of image formation. Present laws of refraction are mainly based on this theory. Which theory? First order theory of image formation. Generally, theta is not very small, so we cannot neglect higher order term. So sine theta is equal to theta minus theta cube upon factorial 3. Here we are taking the value of sine theta up to third order, and hence this theory is known as third order theory of image formation. The theory in which we use above value of sine theta, that is sine theta equal to theta minus theta cube upon factorial 3, is known as third order theory of image formation. So in first order theory of image formation, we use sine theta equal to theta, and in third order theory of image formation, we use sine theta equal to theta minus theta cube upon factorial 3. Thus, third order theory of image formation and the presence of higher order term is responsible for monochromatic aberration, because our present theory of the law of refraction is based on the first order theory of image formation, and here theta is not very small, then sine theta will be equal to theta minus theta cube upon factorial 3. So in this case, third order theory of image formation will be used, and since we are using only first order theory of image formation, so higher order term is responsible for the monochromatic aberration. Now, types of monochromatic aberration. So there are five types of monochromatic aberration, which are spherical, comma, astigmatism, curvature of field, and distortion. But here we will discuss only about spherical aberration and its reduction. So spherical aberration. Now, what is spherical aberration? This is basically type of monochromatic aberration. Now, Lenz formula is 1 upon f equal to 1 upon v minus 1 upon u. In determining this formula, it is assumed that the aperture of lens is very small. Hence, all the rays parallel to the principal axis focuses at a single point. But when aperture of lens is very large, then higher order term of sine theta also plays a major role, and in this case sine theta will not be equal to theta. This time the rays close to the principal axis, that is paraxial rays, forms image very far from the lens, and the rays close to the margin, that is marginal rays, form the image near the lens. It means we cannot get a point image of an point object. Thus, the image of a point object will not be a point, and this effect is known as spherical aberration. Now, this is our diagram. Here we have a point object, this is a convex lens, and this is principal axis. Now, these rays are marginal rays. Marginal rays are the rays which is close to the margin, and these rays forms the image at this point. So this is the image of marginal ray, and it is represented by IM, whereas the ray which is close to the principal axis are known as paraxial rays. So these are paraxial rays, and the focal length of paraxial ray is greater than the focal length of marginal ray. So paraxial ray forms the image at this point, and this is the image of paraxial ray. So here we have image of paraxial ray, and this is the image of marginal ray. In this way, we cannot get a point image of a point object. The image of a point object is this one, and this region is represented by A dash B dash. Here O is a monochromatic point object placed on the principal axis. So this is a monochromatic point object which is placed at principal axis IM. It means this one. IM is the image of O due to marginal rays, and IP means this one. IP is the image of O due to paraxial rays. IMIP means this length. IMIP is the axial or longitudinal spherical aberration. If we place a screen at IM perpendicular to the principal axis, then outer part of O will be focused at IM. And if we place a screen at IP, then the middle part of O will be focused at IP. Now this was our previous diagram. If a screen is placed perpendicular to the axis at A dash B dash, so if we place a screen perpendicular to the axis at A dash B dash means here, then the image A dash B dash is shown in the form of a circular spot. Since the diameter of this spot is found to be minimum, and hence it is known as circle of least confusion. So this is actually the circle of least confusion. The radius of circle of least confusion is known as lateral or transverse spherical aberration. Transverse or lateral spherical aberration is the radius of circle of least confusion. So the radius of A dash B dash will be transverse spherical aberration. The image obtained at this point will be best image. So the image which we get here is the minimum aberrated image, or this is the position where we can obtain the best image of a point object. Now, reduction of spherical aberration. It is minimized by using convex lens of small aperture, and it can also be reduced if the total deviation produced by the lens is equally divided by all the parts of the lens. Since spherical aberration is due to the large aperture of a convex lens, so by minimizing the aperture of a convex lens, we can minimize the spherical aberration, and it can also be reduced if the total deviation produced by the lens is equally divided by all the parts of the lens. Now, first method is by using stops. By using stops, we can reduce the aperture of the lens, and hence we can reduce the spherical aberration. So, here we use a stop, and this stop stops the paraxial rays and allowed to pass the marginal rays. So here we get a point object which is due to marginal ray, and if we want to allow the paraxial ray, then stops will be used here. So here stops stop the marginal ray and allow to pass paraxial ray. So here we get the image of paraxial ray. In this way, by using stops, we can reduce the aperture of the lens, and hence we can reduce the spherical aberration. By using stops, we can cut either the marginal rays or paraxial ray. So here we cut the paraxial ray and here we cut marginal ray. Now second method is by using crossed lens. A crossed lens is a lens whose ratio of the radii of curvature is 1:6, and the refractive index of material of lens is in the ratio of 1:5. This is crossed lens or minimum aberrated lens. For minimizing the spherical aberration, the more curved surface must face more parallel rays, so this side is generally placed towards the incident ray. So by using crossed lens, we can reduce or minimize the spherical aberration. And for minimizing the spherical aberration, the more curved surface must face more parallel rays, so this side is generally placed towards the incident ray. This is our diagram. So this is actually crossed lens. By using crossed lens, we can reduce the spherical aberration. Now next one is by using plano-convex lens. In this case, more parallel beam must be incident on the convex side. So if plane side of plano-convex lens is towards the incident ray, then we get this spherical aberration. And if we place the more curved side of the plano-convex lens towards the incident ray, then the spherical aberration will be minimum. So here spherical aberration is this one, whereas here the spherical aberration is this one. So by using plano-convex lens, we can reduce the spherical aberration, and for it, curved surface or convex surface should face the incident ray. Now next method is by using a convex and a concave lens doublet. In convex lens, Vm is less than Vp. V means the distance of image from the optical center. So here image is close to the lens, whereas in paraxial ray the image is farther apart from the optical center. So this is the case of convex lens. Image of marginal ray is here, and this is the image of paraxial ray. The longitudinal spherical aberration produced by this lens is said to be positive. In concave lens, Vp is less than Vm. It means the image of paraxial ray will be close to the lens. So this is the image of paraxial ray and this is the image of marginal ray. So image of paraxial ray is close to the lens. The longitudinal spherical aberration produced by this type of lens is said to be negative. So the spherical aberration produced due to convex lens is said to be positive, whereas the spherical aberration produced by concave lens is said to be negative. Now, if we use a convex and a concave lens doublet, then we get a point image of a point object. So IM and IP focus at the same point. So this is the point image of a point object. Now, by using a planetic lens, the spherical reflecting surface acts as an aplantic surface and forms the point image of a point object on the axis if u equal to r by mu, and in this case the position of image or the distance of image from the optical center will be mu r. Now this is our diagram. Here we have object and this is the position of image. This is our center of curvature. So object is at a distance of r by mu from the center of curvature, whereas image is formed at a distance mu r from the center of curvature. So O and I are said to be aplantic point, and in this case we get a point image of a point object. Now, by using two convex lenses, so here we have two convex lenses L1 and L2, both are placed at a distance of d. Let O1 be the optical center of L1 and O2 be the optical center of L2. Now, AB ray is incident on L1. If there is no lens, then this ray will follow this path, but due to the presence of L1, it reflects towards BC. And if lens L2 is not there, then the ray BC will move in the direction CF1. So F1 be the focus of L1, but due to the presence of L2, the ray BC reflects towards CF2. And forms the image at F2. So the final image is formed at F2 because the ray is initially parallel to the principal axis. So it will pass through F2 after reflection from the lens system. Let this deviation is delta 1. So delta 1 is the deviation due to L1 and delta 2 is the deviation due to L2. Let BO1 equal to H1 and CO2 equal to H2. If F1 and F2 are the focal length of L1 and L2 and delta 1 and delta 2 are deviations from the lens L1 and L2 respectively. So delta 1 is the deviation due to L1, delta 2 is the deviation due to L2, and F1 and F2 are the focal length of L1 and L2 respectively. Now, the deviation due to thin lens, delta 1 equal to H1 upon F1 and delta 2 equal to H2 upon F2. For minimum spherical aberration, delta 1 equal to delta 2. It means H1 upon F1 equal to H2 upon F2. So H1 upon F1 is equal to H2 upon F2. Now, H1 upon F1 equal to H2 upon F2, and therefore H1 upon H2 equal to F1 upon F2. This was our previous diagram. Now, from triangle BO1 F1 and triangle CO2 F1. So, on comparing triangle BO1 F1 and CO2 F1, we get BO1 upon CO2. Is equal to O1 F1 upon O2 F1. So BO1 upon CO2 equal to O1 F1 upon O2 F1. But BO1 equal to H1 and CO2 equal to H2. So BO1 is replaced by H1, CO2 is replaced by H2, O1 F1 as it is, and O2 F1 equal to O1 F1 minus O1 O2. So O2 F1 is replaced by O1 F1 minus O1 O2. And O1 F1 is the focal length of L1, that is small f1, and O1 O2 is the distance between two lenses, that is D. So H1 upon H2 equal to F1 divided by F1 minus D. So F1 upon F1 minus D, but H1 upon H2 equal to F1 upon F2. So this H1 upon H2 is replaced by F1 upon F2. So F1 upon F2 equal to F1 upon F1 minus D. So F1 upon F2 is equal to F1 upon F1 minus D. And F1 and F1 will be cancelled out. So F2 equal to F1 minus D. And therefore D equal to F1 minus F2. So D equal to F1 minus F2. Now conclusion. D equal to F1 minus F2. So the two convex lenses must be placed at a distance equal to the difference of their focal length to minimize the spherical aberration. Also, the lens of larger focal length should be placed in the front of incident rays. So here we end our session. In the current session, we have discussed about spherical aberration and the reduction of spherical aberration. So goodbye.